NASA basked today in the glory of a technological tour de force. Overnight, after a 350-million-mile journey, the heaviest, most expensive spacecraft ever to land on Mars was gently set down in a giant crater on the red planet.
Touchdown confirmed. We're safe on Mars.
The long-awaited words touched off unbridled celebration late Sunday night at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, California.
Time to see where our curiosity will take us.
Cheers and hugs marked an emotional climax to a journey of more than 8 months for Curiosity. The rover itself even joined the party with a tweet that read, "I'm safely on the surface of Mars. Gale Crater, I am in you." Just minutes later, Curiosity sent back its first set of black and white images from the crater, showing its wheel and shadow. The $2.5 billion project came down to what scientists dubbed the 7 minutes of terror. Depicted in NASA animation, a highly complex series of landing maneuvers never before tried. Curiosity began the atmospheric acrobatics, slicing into the thin Martian air at 13,000 miles an hour. A supersonic parachute deployed to help slow the one-ton object as it hurtled toward the planet. Then the heat shield separated from the rover and the parachute came away. And from there, a kind of sky crane powered by 8 rockets supplied the final braking and used a set of cables to lower Curiosity to the surface at a speed of just 2 miles an hour. From orbit, another U.S. spacecraft, the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter, captured actual images of the parachute deploying. Color photos and video of the landing were expected in the next few days. Meanwhile, back on Earth, the excitement carried into the post-landing news conference. Deputy Project Manager Richard Cook.
So that rocked. Seriously, was that not cool or what? I have been lucky enough to have done this now 4 times, and it never gets old. Seriously, it's just a great experience.
Now that it's on Mars, Curiosity will spend 2 years collecting samples that may show whether there was ever life on the red planet. The robot is loaded with a number of cameras and other tools, including a power drill and a laser. First, though, engineers will check out the systems before sending the craft on a test drive. Some reaction now on a very big day. First, from one of the principal leaders of the NASA team, John Grunsfeld is an associate administrator at NASA. I spoke with him earlier today after Curiosity landed. John Grunsfeld, thank you for joining us and congratulations. I think we heard this in the cheers, but what was the reaction there today?
Well, you know, it was really interesting because, you know, this is the culmination of over 5 years of work, 7,000 people around the country to make the Curiosity rover, the Mars Science Laboratory. And last night here in Pasadena, California at the Jet Propulsion Lab, the Mars Science Laboratory hit the top of the Mars atmosphere for its 7 minutes of terror before it landed safely on the surface. And at each of the critical events, the guided entry, the parachute opening, the sky crane rockets lighting, the lowering down of the crane. It was just one image of disbelief after another that everything was really coming together and working to the point that when the sky crane put the Curiosity rover gently on the surface and we all saw the data that indicated that it had landed, there was almost a moment of silence when people said, wow, it really made it. And then, of course, the team erupted in just jubilation that it had actually worked. And fortunately, the Curiosity rover was programmed to take a couple of quick snapshots and send postcards back, little stamps, if you will, of the images at the landing site. It was the start of that jubilation all over again.
What were you most worried about on this 350-million-mile mission? Were there any indications of trouble, or did things go smoothly the whole way?
Well, amazingly, it was, I would say, pretty smooth the whole way. In fact, so much so that, you know, in the last few days, you know, the few of us were starting to worry that, you know, what have we missed? But this is a very sharp team. You know, they scrutinized everything. You know, we've honed our skills from the Mars exploration rovers, from our Mars reconnaissance orbiter, our experience at other planets, Cassini orbiting Saturn. We just recently launched the Juno mission to Jupiter. So, you know, this is, you know, one of the most talented teams we have at NASA. And at NASA, I think we have the best of the best on planet Earth, maybe even Mars, too. That's one of the things we'll try and find out with Curiosity.
And what are you looking for in the images, in the data coming back from Curiosity? What do you expect to see and to learn?
Well, these early images are just really engineering images, pictures to tell us a little bit about where we landed. And over the next few hours and over the next couple of days, we'll start to get more of a perspective about where we landed. We targeted the Curiosity rover to land in an area called Gale Crater. And specifically, it was targeted because it's a very deep crater, and in the middle is a mountain that's been dubbed Mount Sharp after a Caltech geologist. And in the sides of this mountain, we see evidence that water flowed on Mars. Now, we know that in other places, and we've actually landed now with the Phoenix lander on ice. But what we want to study is the history, the water history and the geological history of Mars. And we can do that just as on Earth we study the Grand Canyon to go back a couple of billion years in Earth's history. On Mars, we can go back even further through the study of sedimentary rocks, through the study of the minerals, to try and understand how did Mars form, how did it evolve, what were the conditions like billions of years ago when Mars was warmer and wetter, and in those times, could Mars have supported life? And maybe if we hit the Grand Slam and there was life on Mars, we might be able to detect in the geology, in the rocks themselves, the chemical signatures of that what would likely have been or we would call microbial life. But that's a long shot. You know, we just have no idea whether, you know, Mars did support life or could have supported life. And that's why we sent Curiosity to answer that question. It's part of the quest. To answer that fundamental human question that we all want to know is, are we alone in the universe? Is there life elsewhere?
John Grunsfeld of NASA, thank you again and congratulations.
Well, thanks very much, and I hope everybody looks forward to a very exciting couple of years on Mars.
And some perspective on this feed now from NewsHour science correspondent Miles O'Brien. He joins us from Houston. Miles, they could barely wipe the smiles off their faces. There was such elation there among the NASA team. Was there a different level of excitement about this than other missions, do you think?
Yeah, Judy, I've got a smile on my face just listening to John, thinking about what lies ahead over the next couple of years as Curiosity starts exploring Mars in ways we have never seen it. But the stakes were so high in this case. The Mars program literally on the line, facing budget cuts. There's a lot of concern about what is next after Curiosity. Matter of fact, even as this landing was occurring, a blue ribbon panel was going through and replanning future missions because of cuts proposed by the Obama administration, which would hit the Mars program very hard. So couple that with the fact that it's $2.5 billion worth of cookies in one basket coming down, not having two rovers as we had in 2004 with Spirit and Opportunity. And it just ratchets up the pressure in ways that are hard to imagine. You know, imagine people having a career where a decade gets baked into that 1 7-minute period, and either you get a gold medal or you don't show up for work the next day. That's what was going on in that room, and so that eruption makes a lot of sense.
So they were feeling the pressure from everywhere and from the public. I mean, the people all over the world were watching this.
Yeah, it's interesting how Mars captivates people, I think, Judy. You know, I think back to the Pathfinder mission in the early 90s. That was one of the first great internet spectacle moments, millions and millions of hits in an era when we weren't on the internet like we were. Last night surpassed any records we can imagine on internet access to a news event. What I think interests people, and what is so exciting about this, it's really unprecedented if you think about it in history, is the average person, armchair scientists, you and I, have access to the same data at virtually the same time that the scientists do. We can all be on Mars together. We can all armchair scientifically analyze all this data together. We're all on Mars as part of this effort together. And there's nothing quite like that in science, really, and there's nothing quite like that in space.
We heard John Grunsfeld explain the search for life, small life, I guess it is, on Mars.
Yes.
Very small life.
Yes.
How much do they know, Miles? Help us understand how much they already know and how much there is yet to discover for them.
Well, we've been going through a slow kind of iterative process of building the story of potential life on Mars. You know, Spirit and Opportunity were all about settling a question that we think we knew, that at one time Mars was warm and wet. Well, they have brought home just volumes of evidence to say that was in fact the case. We don't have to debate that one anymore if there was any debate prior. Now, what else do you need for life? Well, there are three things. You need wherever we have moisture, wherever we have water on this planet, we have life. Wherever we have some source of energy, whether it's the sun or deep down in the ocean coming from the center of the Earth, essentially. And we have to have some sort of carbon material. Those are the three things for life as we know it. So we know that water was once there. Now let's go after this issue of the carbon. And that's what Curiosity is all about. It's going to go through and, you know, think about it. You could take a big drill and try to drill a core sample, or you could take advantage of what Mother Nature did, which was create this huge hole in the ground there with this asteroid 3 billion years ago, which lays bare all these layers of sediment, which reveal 3 billion years of history if you know how to read it. Well, Curiosity knows how to read it. The scientists in Pasadena, JPL, know how to read it. And we're going to be able to tell the story of just what happened along the way there over these next couple of years.
And Miles, do they expect the information is going to come back in a burst at the end of the 2 years or in a steady stream for the next 24 months? I mean, do we know that?
Well, first of all, everybody's got to be a little bit patient on this one. If you recall with Spirit and Opportunity, the pictures started coming down almost immediately. Those were sprint missions designed to last 90 days. Of course, Opportunity is still going 8 years later. So based on that math, I think Curiosity could last potentially 30 years, 30 times longer. The fact is, this is a much more complicated mission. It is baseline for 2 years, which is one Martian year, 98 weeks. And so they're going to take their time understanding this complex machine, how it operates on Mars. The first month, we'll see some images for sure. We're not going to see it move until September. We're not going to see it drill into a rock until later in the fall. So it's going to take a little while. But as it builds up steam, as the pipeline gets going, if you will, we're going to start seeing some science, very intriguing science coming down, I predict.
Well, a very exciting start, and we'll try to contain our impatience. Miles O'Brien.
All right.
Thank you.